Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We all have a dream, and the dream, I think, is personalized medicine. Every colorectal cancer patient should get optimal treatment. And the possibilities seem endless because we can do everything with molecular diagnostic for each and every patient, for each and every tumor. We can provide this kind of data with all kinds of molecular outcomes and genes and amplification and expression arrays. But reality, we can also apply different classifications. There are classifications based on molecular pathway. As we were told this morning, we have the SYN pathway, the MSI pathway, the SYMP pathway. There are new ways to classify colorectal cancer using prognosis-derived expression profiles, which occurred last year in Nature Medicine, together with an expression profile that was made by the Cell of Origin, also Nature Medicine last year. Or we, and especially me as pathologist, can go for morphology, because I like that. There are differences in morphology, and those differences in morphology also reflect differences in prognosis and behavior. But reality is that treatment is still based on tumor stage. We have the early stages, which is currently stage A or 1, in which no adjuvant therapy is given. We have the high risk, stage 2, and we have the stage 3. And actually, these stages are very old. 80 years ago, over 80 years ago, these stages have been developed by Cuthbert Jooks. And they're still very valid, because for every tumor state, we need a personalized approach. And if we're talking about rectal cancer, early rectal cancer, the approach might very well be organ preservation, but there are some issues, especially for the pathologist, to be very much aware of. First of all, I think the previous speakers already mentioned and emphasized it, the risk on lymph node metastasis should be carefully estimated, and we should look for very good biomarkers to predict lymph node metastasis in early disease. One of the things we need to do is a subclassification of invasion depth. You already heard that before, and perhaps we should be looking very careful at the resection margins from local recurrences, just like we do in radical surgery, because there are recurrences in after local excision, and they might very well be lymph node recurrences, but they're also scar recurrences. So we need to look at the resection margins. But let's talk about lymph node metastasis. We know from early studies that all PC1 tumors have a risk of lymph node metastasis, which is somewhere between 9 and 80% if you should believe all literature. But we also know that in Europe, we have the introduction of population screening. In the UK, it has been going on for, I think, 5 years. In Holland, we just started this year. But the population screening will result in an increase of PT1 tumors. And we don't know, actually, whether these PT1 tumors that are screen detected will have the same risk on lymph node metastasis. So we really have to wait for these results. But we do know that local excision is oncologically safe only in the absence of lymph node metastasis. So we really want to know, what can the pathologist do to help you predict lymph node metastasis? And we have already seen many of these factors, but I would like to summarize them. And if you look at the literature, there are numerous studies. And if you restrict yourself to the largest study, so the studies of with more than 50 patients in there. There are approximately 20 studies, or at least there used to be 20 studies 2 years ago when we started this project. And it turns out that together we have almost 5,000 patients. And you can do lots of systematic analysis if you have all these data. And the first thing we like to do to look properly at the depth of invasion. And there is discussion whether you should call this Kikuchi levels or Kudo levels, because when I was in Asia, they told me I should call it Kudo levels, so now I do, but everybody else calls them Kikuchi, but they're actually the same. If you look at these Kudo levels, you see that there is a huge difference in the risk of lymph node metastasis. And if you look at the SM1 tumors, there's a pointer over here. If you look at the SM1 tumors, then you know that there is a very small risk of lymph node metastasis of 2.5. On the other hand, if you look at the SM3, it's almost 20%. So there is an increased risk with an increased depth of invasion. One of the previous speakers already pointed out that these CUDO levels are hard to assess if you don't have the muscularis propria in there. So we need other measurements of tumor growth to deal with that. And you can just simply measure submucosal depth. The other thing you can measure is submucosal width or tumor size. And if you look at the data, you can see that if you have an invasion depth of over 1 millimeter, then you have a largely increased risk on lymph node metastasis. There's a risk ratio of 5.2. You can also take a cutoff level of 2 millimeter, and then your risk ratio is smaller, but you have more specificity. So I will come back to the issue of sensitivity and specificity later. But if you have a 1 millimeter cutoff, you have a high sensitivity and a low specificity. If you go deeper than that, you have a lower sensitivity and a higher specificity. So that's important to remember. If you look at invasion width, there are not so many studies. There are actually only 3 studies. But what they all show is that if you have a tumor which is over 5 millimeter in the submucosa, you have, again, an increased risk on lymph node metastasis. Then there's the tumor types. We have the good ones, we have the bad ones. This is actually a tumor type. If you look from the histological point of view, it looks pretty bad because you don't recognize the typical adenocarcinoma, but it is a good one because it's a medullary carcinoma. And I wouldn't worry if I saw this kind of tumor in a local excision. However, this is a signet ring cell carcinoma, and it's notoriously bad with a very poor prognosis. Mucinous carcinoma, micropapillary, it's very rare. And here there's the normal adenocarcinoma. And actually the data in which we use to predict lymph node metastasis are all based on adenocarcinomas. If you look at the T1 tumors studies that are published in the literature, only 23 cases of mucinous carcinoma are included in these studies. That's because mucinous carcinomas usually present at a higher stage. As for signet ring cell carcinomas, those ones are really, really rare. And in those studies dealing with T1 tumors, only 4 of these are described. So usually they are grouped under the poorly differentiated group. And I think that might be a reason not to go for local excision if you have one of those diagnoses. Differentiation grade has been much studied in normal adenocarcinomas, and differentiation grade depends on how recognizable the histology is. Can you still see something which you can call crypt-like, or is it a more solid growth with more bad-looking nuclei? And if you look at those studies for differentiation grade, you see that the risk on lymph node metastasis is very much increased in the presence of high-grade tumors or poorly differentiated tumors, almost 5 times increased risk. Lymphatic invasion is extremely important. You can imagine that when you have lymphatic invasion, the tumor is already on its way to the lymph nodes. And here you see an example of lymphatics and tumors in there. And lymphatic invasion indeed bears one of the highest risk on lymph node metastasis, or 5.2. However, if you look very careful in the literature, there are different ways in which the studies describe lymphatic invasion. There is lymphatic invasion properly or there is the combination with lymphovascular invasion. And there is, there, of course, there are studies who study vascular invasion per se. And if you look at the relative risks, you see that lymphatic invasion has, of course, the highest relative risk because those cells are on their way to the lymph nodes. But on the other hand, vascular invasion does say something about the risk on the development of distant metastasis, but not on lymph node metastasis per se. And if you group those together, it's not surprising that you come up with an intermediate risk. So it's not very specific to use lymphovascular invasion. Lymphatic invasion per se is the most accurate. Vascular invasion is least accurate, and therefore you should not use lymphovascular invasion because it's suboptimal. If you decide to go for a local excision, I think you should consider to ask your pathologist for immunohistochemistry for lymph vessels, because you want a specific results for lymphatic invasion and not for vascular invasion. We don't usually do that as pathologists, but it's easy. There are specific immunohistochemistry is available, and we can easily do that. And I think it's good patient care. Then there's budding. It's always somewhat of a vague term, and people don't really know what's meant with budding. But budding is something that is happening in the invasive front of the tumor. And here you have the main part of the tumor. It's an immunofluorescent picture, but you can also have it in H&E, but I like this color better. But here you have the main part of the tumor, and at the invasive front, there are all those tiny islands of tumor cells which are growing into the depth. And the single cells, they can be single cells or they can be clusters of cells. But if you read carefully the literature about budding, every study has its own definition. Some studies say a cluster is less than 5 cells, between 5 and 10. You should look at the whole invasive front and count all the buddings, or you should only look at a certain area of the tumor. You should only look for single cells. So all the definitions in the studies are different, and they deal with how large should it be, what area should you do extra stainings, because then you see the buds more clearly. At what magnification should you use for your microscope to detect the buds? And there are some questions about reproducibility. But in all the T1 studies, budding is something which all the times come up as a significant finding. And actually, in the European guidelines for population screening, it says, well, it should not be used because there is no clear definition. But if you look at the evidence, irrespective of what definitions they use, there is a very, very clear relation with lymph node metastasis. So despite the fact that there is no clear definition, it has prognostic impact. And that says something. So if we look at the different risk factors for lymph node metastasis in T1 tumors, you see that lymphatic invasion, submucosal invasion depth, budding, and high-grade histology carry the highest risk ratio for lymph node metastasis, while on the other hand, vascular invasion, other cutoff levels, submucosal wipe are less important. You can also put this in another way, and this is the percentage of positive nodes. If there's budding, you have over 20%. If you don't have budding, 5%. And this goes on for all the different kinds of factors you can think of. So you have to know what your risk is on positive node. But the problem is all these factors interact. So you have to be very careful to make your decision based on one of these factors. And actually, you might think, how valuable are these biomarkers really? Can we really apply those in clinical practice? Can you really tell your patients you have to have a radical operation because you have poor differentiation? Or is that not the case? If you look at the value of biomarkers, there are several issues you can discuss. There's sensitivity, how many patients can be diagnosed as positive in which they really have a high risk. And there's specificity. And if you look at the next slide, there's another picture which might be even more clear. If we look, for example, at submucosal invasion with a cutoff of 1 millimeter or 1,000 micrometer, they have a high sensitivity. So if you have a high sensitivity, you have very few false negatives. But the specificity is very low, so you have a high false positive rate. That means that if you use this as a cutoff, that you will operate many people unnecessary. So this is not a really good marker in clinical practice. On the other hand, if you look at high-grade differentiation, it's not very sensitive. So that means that there are many false negatives. There will be patients with lymph node metastasis who do have good low-grade differentiation, who have good differentiation. On the other hand, it's very specific. So there are very few false positives. That means that most of the high-grade tumors will have lymph node metastasis. Other way you can look at biomarkers is look at the predictive value. You have a positive predictive value and there is a negative predictive value. Positive means that if your test is positive, how likely is it to have a positive result? So if you have a biomarker which indicates a high risk of lymph node metastasis, how often do you have lymph node metastasis? So if we look at these factors again, you see that the positive predictive value for all these different factors is actually fairly low. It's between 10 and 30%. So if you have a marker, you have a limited risk, still a limited risk on lymph node metastasis. However, the negative predictive value are rather high. So if you have a high negative predictive value, that means that if you don't have this risk factor, you have a very low risk on lymph node metastasis. So if you have, for example, a submucosal invasion depth of less than 1 millimeter, you have a very, very low risk on lymph node metastasis. So we can use all these biomarkers or factors, if you like, but you need to be aware of the sensitivity, the specificity, and the predictive value of these things. Now, the neoadjuvant situation, Chris already told us it's being done. But can we reliably predict lymph node metastasis in the neoadjuvant situation? We have to be aware of things changing in the neoadjuvant situation, because if you have the normal, in the cases without neoadjuvant therapy, the risk on lymph node metastasis in the T0 patient is actually zero, because there's no invasive tumor, so there's no risk on lymph node metastasis. However, if you have YPT0, so after neoadjuvant therapy, we know that the risk of lymph node metastasis is approximately 7%, depending a little bit on your selection of cases. And if you have a T1 tumor, the risk after neoadjuvant therapy is 10 or even more. And if you have a T2 tumor, it's 20. So we know after neoadjuvant therapy, the lymph node risk is different than in the normal situation. And this is a study I would like to draw your attention to, because if we have neoadjuvant therapy, it's not always so that the tumors shrink from the outside. The tumors don't go back from a T4 to a T3 to a T1 to a T0. Sometimes it happens, and that's a very good thing, but if you look very carefully, for example, at the YPT2 series here, you see that in only 15% of cases you see aberrations in the mucosa, and only 55% do show tumor in the submucosa. So for T2 tumors after neoadjuvant therapy, there might be very well a bias if you rely on a local excision. You can still have tumor cells in the muscularis without having any tumor cells in the submucosa. And the same holds true for YPT3 and YPT4 tumors. So you need to be aware of that. At the moment, we do not have any reliable pathological risk factors for lymph node metastasis in this situation. So, in conclusion, we have rather well-defined risk factors for nodal disease in T1 tumors. Lymphatic invasion, invasion depth, poor differentiation, and budding are the most important. Be careful how you use them in clinical practice. If you offer a patient neoadjuvant therapy, you should be very careful because complete pathological response of the primary tumor does not imply, per se, free lymph nodes. And actually, since we don't know how to predict lymph node involvement after neoadjuvant therapy, I cannot help you there yet. Thank you very much.